deadline for signing up, the deadline for signing up for health insurance is February. That's not right. Thanks, Obama.
Now we've seen everything, right? The presidential selfie stick in that parody video promoting the government's healthcare website. The video was a BuzzFeed production co-starring a BuzzFeed Films actor. The news and entertainment website also scored an interview with the president. For the most part, presidents often turn to the traditional news conference to get their messages out.
First of all, if we are going to remain a country without
base, the issue of war and peace on a rumor or report.
We shall fight the battle against aggression in Vietnam.
4 out of 5 Central American countries now have democratic governments.
I did not have sexual relations with that woman.
Congress will pass some bills I cannot sign. I'm pretty sure I'll take some actions that some in Congress will not like.
But they've also used non-traditional media to connect with the public.
Sock it to me?
Number 7. Hmm? Make sure the White House library has lots of books with big print and pictures.
Seriously? What's it like for this to be the last time you ever talked to a president?
It must kind of stink.
All right, joining me now, Matthew Iglesias, executive editor at Vox News. That's V-O-X. He interviewed President Obama this past couple of weeks. Ben LeBolt, the press secretary for the Obama 2012 campaign, and John Stanton, Washington bureau chief at BuzzFeed News. And John, I'm just going to put you on the spot right away. How does that work? You wink and you stick the tongue out at the same time?
The winky emoji? Yeah.
Just to show you how not hip I am, I had no idea what that was when I saw the president doing it.
Yeah,
I had to look it up.
I had to ask about what it was, like just making faces in the mirror or if there was something like that. So
what was that all about?
You know, I mean, I think... I don't know a whole lot about how they come up with these crazy ideas for these videos. You know, that's something they do.
And you work there, yeah, right.
Yeah, you know, yeah. I mean, but, you know, I think it's hilarious, right? It was funny and sort of showed a human side of the president, and people really liked it, so I thought it was funny.
And Matthew, over at Vox, you guys had this interview with the president, and it was also sort of in a non-traditional format in that you took the interview, you guys went back, you edited it together, you added some new media flair to the presentation. Why did you take that approach in your interview?
Well, we wanted to try to do something a little bit different. I think people have seen interviews with the president before. It's a great, you know, it's an honor. It's like a big deal if you're a journalist doing one. But to the audience, it may get a little bit stale. So, you know, we wanted to sort of produce something that looked a little bit different, and that meant taking a slightly different approach in terms of the questions we asked so that our team had the time to go and kind of do the animations.
And Ben, let me ask you this, because, I mean, you know the question that I'm going to ask, which is, and you've heard this beef before by people like me in the White House press corps, it feels like the White House more and more is choosing non-traditional media outlets. Now, BuzzFeed does have a news operation, and Vox is obviously a website that does a lot of great journalism as well. But it is sort of going around the folks in the briefing room, around the networks, around the newspapers to get the message out. Why is that? Why is the White House doing this?
Well, the ultimate goal is to reach the American people, and I'm not sure that there's one bully pulpit anymore. When the president walks out into the briefing room, that no longer guarantees that he's going to reach his target audience. So this week, for example, February 15th, there was a healthcare enrollment deadline. He's trying to reach younger people who are uninsured to try to get them healthcare coverage. And the fact is 71% of people under the age of 30 get their news online as their primary source of information now. So he had to go to non-traditional audiences to reach those folks.
And is he trying to get away with not answering the hard questions? Is that what he's up to?
Well, just a few months ago, he was criticized for doing 60 minutes too often. I think if you watch these interviews, sure, there were some things that were different and some things that were a little bit fun, but it was a broad discussion of politics, domestic policy, and foreign policy. We've just gotten past the time when it was 3 networks or so that had a monopoly on a national audience. The president and the White House work to identify the audience he's trying to reach and then go to venues to meet the audience where they are.
And John, obviously your editor, Ben Smith, asked some hard questions in that interview with the president. But then, you know, a day later it comes out, and we're seeing some YouTube video now of when the president shut down with YouTube. But, you know, the next day you come out with this video that shows the president with a selfie stick and so forth. Does that kind of take away from the seriousness of, you know, the interview that you had with the president earlier this week?
No, I don't think so. I think, look, you know, A, there were sort of two separate parts of the company that did it. So, you know, it's not like Ben doing selfie stick pictures with the president, which would be hilarious
Ben's
to see. Don't get me wrong.
Before, I'm sure. Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, so it's a bit like saying, you know, that ABC News should be worried about Marvel doing something with the president, right? No, I don't think that's a problem. But I also think that this is an issue that we in the media definitely talk a whole lot about, and politicians talk a whole lot about, but I don't think news consumers have a problem with sort of chewing gum and walking at the same time, right? I mean, I think they can see the difference between the two things and, you know, accept them for what they are. So.
And Matthew, I mean, one thing that you heard, obviously, in the criticism that came after your interview with the president was that it was sort of a way to, you were trying to explain his answers with the graphics and so forth, and almost a supporting role is what some conservative commentators said after that interview. What is your response to that?
Well, you know, I mean, it's not a surprise that conservatives don't love an interview with the president. They don't like the president. You know, they don't agree with what he's saying. I thought it was a good way to illustrate some of his points. You know, when people are able to speak freely, they sometimes speak a little bit imprecisely. I asked him a question about foreign aid. He said something like, well, it's 1-2% of the budget. We were able to show exactly what it is. It was, I think, 1.6%.
And there was one part in the interview where he sort of misspoke and it described the terror attack at the Paris deli as being random, when obviously it wasn't random. There were anti-Semitic motivations there. And we tried to ask the White House press secretary about that, Josh Earnest, and he sort of fumbled the answer to that question as well. So in these interviews, and I'm a big believer in almost all presidential interviews make news, no matter what the questions are, because sometimes just letting the president speak, he'll make news.
Yeah, I mean, it's true. That was an interesting moment. You know, I don't think the president meant to deny there was an anti-Semitic motivation there. He had said it before. His administration had said it before.
Right.
But what he said in the interview was random. And then members of his staff, I think, sort of fumbled follow-up questions. And it became, you know, a story for a day or two. I don't think, from my point of view, that was not, like, the most interesting thing that happened in that interview. But it goes to show, you know, whenever you get the president on camera, something can happen.
And, Ben, I mean, I have to ask you this. What makes you cringe the most? The president sitting down with a BuzzFeed or a Vox or 60 Minutes or CNN? Which is the one that has you bracing for impact the most?
Well, I think Matthew hit on a good point. When you prepare for a Sunday show interview, when you prepare the president for that, he spends hours in preparation, thinking through everything he said in the past and detailed questions that could come in. Sometimes it's the interviews in a relaxed setting that are the most dangerous. It's a free-flowing conversation. It's harder to predict the questions. Those are the sorts of times when it's easiest for the president or any elected official to go off message.
Okay, and I'll wrap this up here by taking a quick selfie of all of us here on set. I don't know if I'll get us all in there, but I'll try.
You need a selfie
stick. Okay. Yeah, I need a selfie stick. I didn't bring my selfie stick. All right. John Stanton, Matthew Iglesias, Ben Lebolt, thanks for your time. We